the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. We thank our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for another Bible preach session. It is 7 p.m. All the way from Sydney, Australia. To those who are with us in this holy church and those who are watching us through live streaming, I pray that you are always in good health and in good spirit in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. If I could ask everyone to stand for the Lord's Prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgave our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Psalm number 72. Give the king your judgments, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. He will judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. The mountains will bring peace to the people and the little hills by righteousness. He will bring justice to the poor of the people. He will save the children of the needy and will break in pieces the oppressor. They shall fear you as long as the sun and moon endure throughout all generations. He shall come down like rain upon the grass before mowing, like showers that water the earth. In his days the righteous shall flourish, and abundance of peace until the moon is no more. He shall have dominion also from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. Those who dwell in the wilderness will bow before him, and his enemies will lick the dust. The kings of Tarshish and of the Isles will bring presents. The kings of Sheba and Seba will offer gifts. Yes, all kings shall fall down before him. All nations shall serve him. For he will deliver the needy when he cries, the poor also, and him who has no helper. He will spare the poor and needy, and will save the souls of the needy. He will redeem their life from oppression and violence, and precious shall be their blood in his sight, and he shall live, and the gold of Sheba will be given to him. Prayer also will be made for him continually, and daily he shall be praised. There will be an abundance of grain in the earth. On the top of the mountains, its fruits shall wave like Lebanon, and those of the city shall flourish like grass of the earth. His name shall endure forever. His name shall continue as long as the sun, and men shall be blessed in him. All nations shall call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only does wondrous things, and blessed be his glorious name forever, and let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. The prayers of David, the son of Jesse, are ended. And all glory be to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, a very good evening to everyone. How are we? Can't hear you. I can't hear you. I can't hear you. You people of Sydney, I don't know, sometimes I just wonder. Hey, Gowan, mate. All right. Any new faces for the first time? One over there, one over, a couple of here. Oh, over here, wonderful, wonderful. Thank you very much. Well, for those who are joining us here for the first time, a very warm welcome. I pray that this is not going to be the last time, and I pray that I continue seeing you for the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I want to hear the amen. All right, we are continuing our journey. Before we continue our journey, I will hand it over to our beloved daughter in Christ, our beloved Nora, and with her angelic voice, we begin this evening with this church hymn, dear Nora. To that. We love and adore our Holy Mother. She is the Virgin of all virgins forever. She is the Mother of our Lord, our God, our Savior. This is undeniable forever. The Holy Mother has a very unique place, first and foremost, in the heart of Christ and in the Church, the true Church of Christ that venerates the Holy Mother and the saints. And speaking of saints, today was the feast of Saint Mary, which I have sort of been given this name. I don't know how the Lord operates. Out of all the crows in this world, He chose like a crow like me to give me this such a holy name. I just wonder why. So Saint Mary, he was one of the 70 disciples chosen by Jesus Christ Himself while he was in the flesh on earth. The Lord chose 12 and then 70 while he was still on earth. So Saint Mary happened to be one of the 70 disciples. He moved on or passed away in 82 AD. So that's a very early stage of Christianity, 82 AD. By the end of his life on earth, he had already established around Baghdad. I was actually born in Baghdad, Iraq, or Mesopotamia. So I come from Iraq and born in Baghdad. So around Baghdad, at the end of his life, he had established 365 churches and monasteries. So you could see that he was extremely active disciple and a servant of the Lord Jesus. He was truly a magnificent servant, had done a lot of miracles, a lot of wonders, and brought a lot of people to the Lord Jesus in the thousands in that specific region of the Middle East. May his prayers be with all of you and with all of us, my beloveds. We need the prayers of the saints, and more so the prayers of the mother of all saints, our sweetheart and my sweetheart. I adore my mom, Mother Mary. We ask them to pray and lead us and guide us to the one and only Jesus Christ of Nazareth, for he is the truth, he is the way, the truth, and the life. In him, everything lies. In him, everything is made possible. In him, existence was brought and made possible. Jesus Christ, perfect God, perfect man, forever. Amen. Thank you very much for coming. All right, this evening we're going to continue with the book of Revelation. We are now at chapter number 10. Chapter 10, we're going to read from verses 1 to 3. I have asked the Lord to help me to speak much shorter than I usually do. I've been lately going for 2 hours. I said, what am I doing? I'm killing these people, poor thing. So I'm going to try and be 3 hours today, if that's possible. All right. So Revelation 10, verses 1 to 3. Here we go. I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. He had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea, and his left foot on the land, and cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roars. When he cried out, 7 thunders uttered their voices, and all glory be to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, forever and ever. Amen. Just a small intro. We are still going through the 7 trumpets. And we said the trumpets are the warnings. Because at the beginning they were the seals, and then the trumpets, and then there is the bowls. The seals are the promises of God. Every word he had said, every word that he has mentioned, every promise he said, he is there to make it. God will never change his mind. So the seals are the promises of God, and he is reminding us that he is with us always. The Lord said, I will never leave you orphans. I am with you all the days of your life and until the end of all ages. All the days of your life, that means literally all the days of your life. In the good times, bad times, in darkness and in the light, when you have fallen so deep and when you are up so high, he is with you all along. He has never forsaken you. He has never forgotten you. He has never left you behind, even though we sold him with 30 pieces of silver. He still calls us friends. That is the promise. And then after the promises, warnings, trumpets. When a trumpet is made, that is something is coming. It's preparing you for something that is coming ahead. And we are in the warnings now. And we said there are 7 seals, 7 trumpets, 7 bowls. The bowls are the judgment of God on the entire globe. After the warnings, judgment. Those who adhere to the warnings will be delivered. Those who do not, they will be judged by the Almighty God. Now, the trumpets are 7. The seals are 7. The bowls are 7. We said the first trumpet, second, third, fourth, These are just preparing us. 5th, 6th, and 7th, the 5th, the 6th, and the 7th are entering into the Great Tribulation. Now we are in the 6th trumpet. The 6th trumpet was chapter 9 and chapter 10. The 7th trumpet will come towards halfway through chapter 11. So the 6th trumpet is fairly long. Why? Because it's going deep into the end times. The 6th trumpet. So the 6th trumpet is your 21st century, which is the end of times. So we are living the end of times 100%. If anybody says to you, no, this is an exaggeration, it's too much, it's your head is going too far. No, my dear friend, we need to be awakened, we need to be alert, reading the signs, because we truly are into the depth of the end times. Now, in chapter 10, it says, I saw still another mighty angel. Because in chapter 9, this voice said, that came from the four corners of the golden altar, release the four angels that are bound at the great river Tigris, or Euphrates, beg your pardon. Release the four angels that are bound at the great river Euphrates. And when they were released, they were going to kill one third of the human race. One third of the human race will perish. Looks like nuclear war is imminent. And it's going to happen anyway. Sooner or later, World War III will commence. And World War III, that means there will be nuclear warheads used. And that's going to make one third of the population perish from existence. Or from the face of this earth, at least. So now he's saying he saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. Now, the translation in English is not 100% accurate. In here, the New King James uses mighty angel, but the original text says a mighty person was coming down from heaven. So instead of an angel, it is a mighty person. So I saw still another mighty person coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. Now, this kind of a description can only qualify for Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There is no angel that has all these descriptions. No one. It's only the Lord Jesus. So he saw another mighty person coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. Cloud. When we look in the Old Testament, the Israelite nation, during the day when they walked, there was a pillar of cloud overshadowing them for the sun not to strike them. And at nighttime, there was a pillar of fire to lighten the way and to give them warmth. So that cloud that followed the Israelite nation wherever they went, and even when they built the tabernacle, the tent where they came to worship Yahweh, the God of Israel, when they came to worship the Lord, the cloud would come down in the midst of them. And that cloud was the presence of God in the midst of his nation, of his people. So this mighty person coming down from heaven, and he was clothed with a cloud, meaning this mighty person that is coming down from heaven is God himself. He's clothed with a cloud, and the cloud in the Old Testament was resembling the presence of the Almighty God. So this person is God himself, God revealed in this person, and that's why this person in this chapter 10 verse 1 is Jesus Christ, no one else. And also, clothed with a cloud, the clouds, my beloved, in other parts of the Holy Bible, that symbolically represents the saints. When you read in the book of Ecclesiastes, King Solomon, Old Testament, book of Ecclesiastes, in chapter 1, King Solomon talks about the sun, talks about the wind, talks about the ocean. And when he talks about the three, the sun, the wind, and the ocean, he says all of them, they go in circle. The sun goes up, and then the sun comes down, and then it runs again to go up again from where it initially went up. So going in circle. He said the wind blows from the north, comes to the south, and goes back to the north. North, on the map of any country, on the map, north is at the top, south is at the bottom. So he says the winds comes from the top down to the bottom and then goes back up and down, go in a circle. He says the rivers, they go into the ocean and the ocean is never full. Why? Because the rivers were formed from the ocean. How? He said God used the sun to strike its beam of light on the ocean. And when the water became really hot, the water on the surface of the ocean evaporated. When it evaporated, it became lighter than liquid. So that vapor started going up. When it went up, at the top is north. At the top, there is wind. The wind up there is much cooler and colder than the wind at the bottom. So when the cool wind hit that vapor, it turned into a what? Cloud. That cloud is full of water. That water was in the ocean, but it evaporated because of the heat of the sun. So there is a distillation here that took place. That ocean's water is salty, but the water that is in this cloud is sweet. And when the cloud became too heavy, needed to drop the weight. That's where the rain comes down. When the rain came down, rivers were formed on the land. And the water needs to run. Water can't stop. And water started running and found its way back to the ocean where it came from. But you see, for the salty water to change into sweet water, sun had to heat up that water. And the sun in the Song of Solomon, in the Song of Solomon says, the sun of trials. So saints, how are they formed? Through immense trials. We once upon a time belong to the world. The world is resembled by the ocean. Every time you read in the Holy Bible, talks about the sea is the world, the land is Israel. So once upon a time, all of us belonged to the world. We were that ocean, salty water. And the salty water, you cannot drink it. There is plenty of salty water around. Just the Pacific Ocean is huge. Before the pandemic, I used to fly out to America. From Sydney to LAX, 14-hour flight. From the time the plane takes off till the time the plane lands in LA, it is flying over the Pacific Ocean. 14-hour flight of water underneath you. There is so much salty water. The world is huge compared to the faithfuls. The faithfuls are driplets. The faithfuls are rivers. But the world is the ocean. Rivers, their size compared to the ocean is very small, minute. That's why out of the entire world, you will find a handful of people that are loyal to Christ. The majority have denied Him. So we were one of those people before. We were the ocean. Salty water, good for nothing. What happened? The Lord Jesus wanted to transform us. Like St. Paul mentions in his epistle to the Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. He wanted to transform us. How he changed us from salty water to sweet? Through trials, my beloved. The sun is the trials that we go through. The hardships, the heavy burden, the difficult times, the dark tunnels in our life. The Lord is forming us, shaping us, burning us in order to change that salty water into sweet water. It takes a lot of burning. It takes a lot of effort to change that salty water into sweet water. But once you become sweet, where do you end up? In heaven, not on earth. Salty water is on earth. The cloud is in the sky. For the Lord to elevate you, for the Lord to change your way of thinking, He needs to drag you out of this filth. He needs to drag you out of this lustful world, this dark world, evil world. He needs to take you out of this. He needs to give you a new mind, a new way of thinking, a new lifestyle. He wants you to become heavenly. Stop living in this filth. The more you dig into this world, the dirtier you become. It is nothing but mud. It is nothing but filth, my beloved. Stop chasing the world. The world will give you nothing but evilness. So, he's clothed with a cloud. St. Paul in Ephesians chapter 5, he says, the church is the body of Christ. Clothing normally goes on the body. So he's clothed with what? A cloud. His body is the saints. Those who were baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. But not everyone who is baptized will make it to be a clothing of Christ. It is those who last till the end, those who endure till the end, those who will remain faithful and loyal to Jesus Christ till the end are the clouds that will be covering the body of Christ. It's not easy to follow the Lord Jesus, but it's not hard either. It all depends on the human will. What are you willing to choose? How far are you willing to go? How long are you willing to last? You need to choose. And the moment we choose Him, the rest is history. He will never let go of you. You will, along the way you will, but He won't. Because He made a promise. I am with you all the days of your life and until the end of all ages. You walk astray, I am the good shepherd seeking the lost sheep. You fall, I'll put you back on your feet. You go into the grave, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even if he dies, shall live. But he who eats my body and drinks my blood will live in me forever. These are the seals, the promises of Christ to all those who believe in Him and trust in Him. He is clothed with a cloud. The cloud is the church, the saints of Christ. Since the clouds are the saints, well, of course, and a rainbow was on his head. Rainbow, huh? Oh, what a feeling, Toyota. It's hot in here? Yes? It's my presence. And a rainbow on his head. The rainbow is the promise of God to humanity. At the great flood, the Ark of Noah, when the Lord God flooded the whole globe, And every human being perished except 8 people. It was Noah, his wife, his 3 children, and 3 daughter-in-laws. 8 people entered the ark. After the flood had receded, rainbow appeared in the sky, and God said, I will never, I make a promise, and my promise is this rainbow, I will never bring rain on the face of this earth that will flood the entire globe. I will never flood the world with water. But God did not promise, I will not burn the globe with fire. But he promised he's not going to bring a flood. So they can do cloud seeding, but they ain't going to succeed. Because the Lord will burn the world with fire, not water. With fire. That's a promise. Yeah? Yes. So now, the rainbow came out after the great flood. And he said, no more flood. That's a promise. And that promise, he said, the rainbow was what? Over his head. Why over the head? Because the head is where the thought is, where the word is. Meaning, you are in my thought. Always, even when I come to bring judgment on the face of this world, you are in my thought. Those who are seeking me, those who are chasing after me, those who believe in me, even when I come to bring fire to the world, those who belong to me, you are in my thought. I never, never forsake you. I will deliver you. I've made a promise. No more I will kill those who love me and are after me and be wanting to be with me in the end. I am the God who sticks to his word and delivers everything he says. The rainbow is a promise of deliverance. Was on his head, his face like the sun. Well, if he was clothed with a cloud, the saints, if the saints are the body, or members in the body of Christ, I should say, then the face of Christ is the sun. Because it is the sun that made this cloud possible. Remember? The sun struck the ocean, heated the water, evaporated it, and at the top, the cold wind strike that vapor, turned it into a cloud. So the sun, Jesus Christ, the S-U-N and the S-O-N, made this worldly person into a heavenly divine person. Therefore, the face is like the sun. No, I'm doing okay. We're going to be finished before 1 hour. That should go into the Guinness Book of Record. The good old good-looking bishop has preached for less than 1 hour. That is a miracle. Come on, love. Because I see you guys all serious and scared, and what's going to happen? And his face was like the sun. Look at this. And his feet like pillars of fire. Why the feet are like pillars of fire? Because trumpet number 6, not Trump, trumpet number 6 is gone deep into the end of times. So the Lord is coming to judge. He's not coming to say hello. No, in his first coming, he was nice and kind. The second coming, he will not tolerate nonsense. So what are his feet like? Pillars of fire. Fire is judgment. You see, the Lord perished the world with water at the beginning. In the end, he will perish it with fire. So fire is judgment. Because St. Paul says, everything gets tested with fire. The grass, the wood, the brick, The silver, the copper, the silver, the gold, everything gets tested with fire. So his feet are like pillars of fire. Because the Lord is saying, when I come back on my second return, the world will be so evil, my feet need to be like fire in order to overcome the evilness of that generation. And he said it. He said, when the Son of Man comes back again, will he find faith on earth? No. The whole world would have denied him. And are we tasting some of that in our time and age? Are we? Yes. If you look at the church, now look, the Lord is focused on the church. He's not focused on the world. The world has a day to be judged, but the Lord's children is the church. The Lord gets angry with the church, not with the world, because the world never accepted him. But those who have accepted him, he made them the sons of God. He made them the heirs to the throne and the children of the kingdom. Now he's got a connection with the church. When you look at the church nowadays, very sad. You know, when the church is living or enjoying freedom, it's very easy to love the Lord. It's very easy to speak about the Lord because everything is easy. I have the full right to say whatever without anyone stopping me. I can preach inside, outside, on the roof, in the street, anywhere. I've got freedom. The government is not telling me nothing. So when you come in good days of enjoying freedom, and then you start preaching so eloquently about the Lord Jesus, well, that is not an effort. But when are you gonna really prove that you belong to Jesus Christ? When that freedom is taken away from you. The narrow door, not the wide gate, the narrow door. Now, when I speak about the church, I'm one of the leaders, so I'm talking about myself. So if anybody says you're judging, I'm not. I'm talking about myself, my dear friend. I'm not judging. If you're going to tell me that today the church is seeking Christ, I'll say to you, you're lying. It's seeking its own glory, yes. It's seeking its own thrones, yes. It's seeking its own image, yes, but not Christ. And I'm talking in general. There are still wonderful clergymen, absolute saints. There are priests, bishops, cardinals, and some popes, not all, but some, absolutely magnificent. But in general, those clergymen that want to promote Christ, not promote, that is not the, it's a weak sort of illustration. Those who want to serve the Lord from the heart, those who want to go and embrace the entire world and bring it to the world, to the Lord, they are not given the opportunity by their hierarchies. Don't talk too much about Jesus Christ. Listen, you're going to cause us a lot of trouble, right? And you're going to make the members upset. So stop talking about Jesus. Make it short. Your sermon, no more than 10 minutes. It's a drive-through service, okay? Half an hour, 15 minutes, enough. Let them go. What? Here I remember Padre Pio. He always comes to my mind. Oh, he's Catholic, I'm Orthodox. Whoa. Please, in heaven, there is none of this nonsense. In heaven, there is no Catholics Orthodox. There is children of God that belong to Christ. Don't ever think you're going to be Catholic up there or Orthodox up there. Please get it out of your head. But as a Christian first, then an Orthodox bishop, I'm proud. I'm proud of that. But that doesn't mean I'm the right way and everyone is wrong. That's an ignorant statement. My beloveds, the Lord Jesus, He was the greatest revolutionist in the history of mankind. If you think and say, oh, Jesus is nice, Jesus is kind, yes, but He was not very kind always. He was sharper than a sword. He stood in the faces of the hierarchies of government leaders and said in their face, you are the sons of the snake. He called King Herod a fox. When they came to him and they said, Herod wants to kill you. He said, look, I've got today, tomorrow, and the next to complete my work. So go and tell that fox. Because when it comes to the truth, there is no compromising. There is no hypocrisy. But my beloved, nowadays, when someone in the church wants to speak the truth, they get silenced by the hierarchies. Because there is too much at stake. You know why people went against the Lord Jesus? Well, there was a few reasons. It's not that they didn't know that this is the true Messiah. Come on, you meet Jesus even in the flesh. You meet Him, you will, the least of everything, of all, you would say, this man is different. This is the least you will say. Without Him opening His mouth, let alone raising the dead and healing the sick and doing wonders, come on, that will blow anyone's mind away. But just by seeing Him passing by, you'll say, whoa, who is this man? But the reason why they went against Him, because they realized this reality. If we acknowledge that this is the Messiah, we will lose our fame, our prestigious life, our comfort zone. We will lose it. Why? Because this Messiah is saying, if you have two shirts, give one to the needy. If you see the homeless, feed him. If you see the sick, visit him. He said, no, I cannot let go of my prestigious life and my comfort zone for the sake of the Messiah. So, since I cannot afford to lose my prestige, I need to lose him. And today, the same thing is happening. The church doesn't want to lose her reputation in front of the world, so forget about Jesus. Let's please government leaders and people of the world, because they look after us. Jesus doesn't. Shame on such leaders. Shame. And it is a shame, because one day this spirit will leave this body. And when the spirit leaves the body, I'm going to have to face Jesus Christ of Nazareth. My goodness, He is the mighty one that came down from heaven. He is the mighty one. We need to pray, my beloveds, for the church. We need leaders that will stand for the Lord and will speak the truth, regardless what the outcome and the consequences are going to be. Let me tell you, we've been striked by YouTube, by the way. That's why we can't live stream on YouTube. It's only Facebook. They've given us a warning for a week. Yeah. Because they are people of the world. Maybe what I've said now is going to give me another strike. Yeah. But it's all good. Apparently something we said back in May 2021. That is against their policy. So much for democracy and freedom of speech, which is the biggest lie of the 20th and the 21st century. Democracy. Please, if you're going to believe in democracy, that is the biggest deception. There is no democracy. There is slavery in a nice way. Like, we'll make you dress and you can put the makeup on and look gorgeous like Celine Dion, but we're going to make you a slave. It's slavery. There is no democracy. And God help us with the current government. It's not up to them anyway. What is happening in the world, only Christ can do something about it. No one else. No one else. No one else, my beloved. Anyway, we need to move on. I need to stick to my 1 hour. And his feet like pillars of fire. He needs to come. It's an evil time. He's going to come with fire because there is too much evil. He had a little book open in his hand, and he sat his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. He had a little book open in his hand. Wow. You know, at the very beginning, when we came to talk about the seven seals, at the very beginning, there was a scroll, a book, but it was closed. The book at the beginning was closed, but the book at the end is open. And it's a little book. Why is it a little book? Because when the book is sealed, what does that tell us? There is secrecy. I don't know what's inside. It's hidden. But when the book is open, everything is clear and it's vivid. It's in the light. It's a little book that is opened. Why? Because when the Lord comes back again, those who are going to be for Him are going to be only few. The majority would have denied Him. So the majority will face a closed book, but the minority will face an open book, meaning the Lord will come to judge, but those who are His, He will tell them exactly what He's about to do before even He does it. Remember Sodom and Gomorrah? Oh, rainbow. Sodom and Gomorrah. What did the Lord God say about Sodom and Gomorrah? He said, I'm going to burn it, but how can I do this without letting my friend Abram know? I can't go and burn it unless I consult with Abram. Excuse me, you're God. Why do you need Abram? He's a servant. No, he belongs to me. He's mine. He's my child. Therefore, I, as a father, will never do anything unless my son knows what I'm doing. So he went and spoke to Abram. And he told him what he's about to do. My beloveds, those who do not accept Jesus Christ, to them He is God. Those who accept Jesus Christ, to them He is their daddy. It is the same person. To the world, He is God. To the church, He is Father. Now I ask you, when you are the child, you live at home, isn't it? A stranger doesn't live at home. It is only the child that lives at home. When you live at home, you see your dad, you hear your dad, and dad comes and tells you, my son, I'm going out now. I'll be back in an hour or two. Or dad will call you and say, son, I want to buy a car. Are you coming with me? Daddy, mommy, speak to the children, explain things to children. Why? Because they are family. They are part of this household. But mom and dad, the same people, will not go and talk to the children of the neighbor and say, we are thinking of buying a house. None of their business. Why should I tell a stranger what I'm doing? I only tell my son, my daughter what I'm doing, because whatever is mine is theirs. It's exactly like that. The scroll is closed for the ungodly, but the little book is open for the godly people that belong to Jesus Christ. So when he comes to judge, he will tell you, he'll reveal to you, he'll say, I'm coming and fire is gonna precede me. But before I bring that fire, my son, my daughter, I have told you, so you are aware of it. And when the fire comes, you will be delivered. Nothing is gonna touch you. That's why the book is open. The Lord will reveal to those who belong to him what is coming ahead. You know, when I look at the world, from the biggest calibers in the world to the smallest calibers in the world, I see them acting childishly, foolish, absolute little kids, playing in the mud. I don't know, like, we have America, the superpower of the world. China now is surpassing America. And they want to get Taiwan. And Taiwan says no. Ni ha tu ha. And then North Korea. Oh, and then Japan says we're not happy about China trying to overtake Taiwan. America says no. Australia says no. China says ha ha ha. When you look at the whole picture, what is this? Like, it can't be any more ridiculous than this. It cannot be any more childish than this. But you are grown-ups. You are supposed to be adults. You're supposed to be mature people, wise people. Make jet fighters and rockets. There's got to be a big brain behind that. But that brain, without God, is ignorant. Who is an ignorant person? The one that says, I can build a rocket to kill myself. What a wise person. Congratulations, you've built a rocket. It's got a nuclear warhead. It can wipe the world. Well done, brother. So you're gonna wipe yourself? Yes. I'm genius, aren't I? Well done, Elon Musk. Jeffrey Epstein had his own island where he invited big caliber people of high places, royal families, presidents, prime ministers, and big boys. And that island, he bought it with a lot of millions. Jeffrey, where did you die? In a little cell, in a dungeon, in a prison. People wake up. People wake up. Big deal, China is a superpower. Big deal, America is a superpower. It is ignorance at its best. Ignorance. You're killing each other. You cannot be more foolish than this. If you had God in your hearts, if you had God in your lives, all the billions and the trillions, why do we have to have people starving to death all over the world? Why do we have little children left orphans without mom and dad, killed in wars? Why do we need to have people slaves? Why? You know why? Because there is nothing good in a human that has no good God in their heart. Nothing good will come out except evilness. Because goodness has one source. That source of goodness is called Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Period. Period, my beloveds. Period. And he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. Why the right foot on the sea and the left on the land? Right represents strength, power. Left, weakness. The right power was on the sea. Why? Because the sea is the world, the land is Israel. Israel are a little minute number of people compared to the rest of the world. There is about 6 million Israelis that live in Israel, surrounded by 400 to 500 million Arabs. So that's 5-6 million compared to 400 to 500 million. So that land, he put his left foot, the weakness, because they are minute. Oh, I can get these people, no problem. But the world, he put his right foot, because the world, there's billions of them. They need to be controlled more. I need to show more power to the world than to Israel. Oh, I'll get Israel in the end, no problems. There are few, and I'll bring him to me. And the Lord will bring Israel back to him. The Israelis will believe in Jesus Christ and will come back through the great tribulation, which is targeted to Israel and then to the rest of the world. But it's mainly targeted to the house of Jacob, Israel. When any human being, and when I speak about Israel, I'm not focusing on Israel. No, but the Lord is talking and giving examples of how everyone should live. When any human being focuses on themselves and focus on the world, they will search for the strongest, for the most powerful. But since you're focusing on yourself and on the world, definitely you are not searching for God. So you're going to search for the most powerful being in this world. Israel, in 1918, they held on to Great Britain because it was the superpower of the time. The Balfour Treaty, where the Prime Minister of Great Britain said, now we declare Israel to be an independent nation. That was the Balfour Treaty in 1918. Great Britain fell straight after World War II ended. Who continued the legacy? United States of America. So they went and held on to United States of America, the most powerful nation. United States is going to go, they'll hold on to China, or whichever superpower comes along after America. And by the way, remember this. When America really falls, the Christians will be persecuted immensely. The next superpower that comes after America will persecute the Christians in a very, very big way. Because the next superpower will be totally godless, totally ruthless. It's a dragon. What does the Bible talk about? What is dragon? Satan. Oh, it's fun. We go and watch these shows. Oh, the dragon is dancing. What dragon? Dragon? Habibi, wake up. The Holy Bible says that dragon is Satan. In America, there are still some great governors. There are still some wonderful people that love the Lord Jesus. You don't find that in any other superpower, except Russia. I'm talking about the church in Russia. Because there are some great saints in Russia. And some great Christians in Russia. Very faithful to the Lord. Very loyal. We'll see. And cried with a loud voice, and when a lion roars. So the Lord Jesus cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roars, and when he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. He cried with a loud voice like a roaring lion. When the lion roars, everybody hears. The Lord will roar to those who belong to him. He will pre-warn them. He will tell them what is going to happen before it happens. And when it happens, I will save you even if they kill you. Lord, please take me. You know what? The worst case, I'll get killed. Right? A bullet in my head, in my chest. That's it. Oh, they chop my head. A couple of seconds, gone. Not even. Good. Thank you very much. But you know what? You cannot touch the Spirit. You cannot take me away from my Lord. And at the end, those who are murderers, they will die themselves. So they will not escape death. So if they are happy by killing people, they'll be killed. And if they don't get killed, they will die eventually anyway, because biologically speaking, everybody must die. So how long do you want to live? You want to eat everything organic? You want to iron your face, stretch your skin? You'll die. Augustus Caesar thought he was going to live forever. He was like a god. They worshipped Augustus Caesar like a god. He's rotted, gone. And so many kings and emperors, all gone. So do you think these people now, they're going to last forever? No. Everybody dies. Secret societies, they're all going to die. They're humans, made out of dust. And the breath of life came from God. Only God gives life and only God takes it. No one can neither stop life nor stop death, because it came from God. Elohim. Or Elohim in Aramaic. So my beloveds, what I'm trying to say, or what the Holy Bible is saying, in whatever situation you may be, and whatever time frame you may be, you need Jesus Christ of Nazareth in your life, period. I beg of you, all the young men and women that are here and those who are watching us, especially the younger generation, my beloveds, I beg of you, don't chase the world. Don't look at what the world is doing. Do not imitate what girls and boys are saying, doing, walking, dressing up. Do not imitate them. I beg of you, don't say, look at this girl, she is half naked. Don't say, look at this guy, he is full of tattoos and earrings everywhere. You do not belong to the world. You belong to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I beg of you, look at Christ and make yourself beautiful in the eyes of Christ, not the world. Because the world is evil, satanic. Let Jesus see you beautiful. Let Jesus see you handsome. Make your heart beautiful to the Lord, for the Lord, not your face beautiful for the world. I beg you, I beg of you, I beg of you, be close to Jesus Christ. Because this is the only truth. Have fun, enjoy life with the Lord. You can still go out to a restaurant or a cafe and eat and drink and enjoy the moment with your loved ones, but let Jesus be part of this gathering. Don't invite Satan, invite the Lord. The Lord did not say you can't have fun. He gave you the world and the beauty of the world, but he said enjoy it with me, because I created it, not you, not Satan. I, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I gave it because you're my son. I wanted to make you happy. I wanted my child to have a gift, and I gave you the gift of life. But enjoy this life with the life giver, not with the life taker, Satan, but with the life giver, Jesus. Go out. I'll come out with you if you invite me. I'll come out with my long skirt too and the red belt in karate. And I'll say, Bruce Lee, eat your heart out, baby. This is the cobra. I'll come out with you. Downtown, uptown, side town, new town, whatever you want. Oh, there is new town too. Yes. That was not intentional. It just came like that. I'll come with you. We'll sit at Mecca's. No, not Mecca's. Don't worry about Mecca's. We'll have fun. And actually, one day I was in America. They took me to this restaurant. And as I was walking, this family was coming out with a young boy. I don't know, 7, 8. He said, oh, Halloween outfit. I said, no, brother, I'm the real deal, baby. This is ain't Halloween. I am the real deal. What's up, brother? Yeah. So it is okay to laugh. It is okay to have fun. Believe me, with the Lord, it's much more precious, much more meaningful. There's much more depth to it and value to it. Believe you me, the world is beautiful with the Lord. It is ugly outside of Him. It's evil. It's suffocating. Just take me to clubbing and see what I'll do there. I'll blow it up. I just walk in, I say, Allahu Akbar, boom. You know, when it was still, the world was living in those turmoil times with ISIS and all that. And, you know, I used to go to America. Oh, at the airport, man. I can see those custom officers speaking to each other, whispering, oh, here's Osama bin Laden coming. And then the funniest of all, I go through this machine and then there is that guy waiting for me with that beeper. Oh, this is a random check, sir. I said, yeah, right, a random check. Do you have any bombs? Yeah, what kind would you like? Anything? A hand grenade? A TNT? What would you like? Yeah, so it's good. It's all fun. We need the Lord Jesus, my beloved. When He cried out with a loud voice, seven thunders uttered their voices. Seven thunders, and I'll leave you with it. I'm doing pretty good. Seven thunders. Seven thunders are fire, water, earth, air. When you see cyclones, when you see rain, when you see earthquakes, when you see massive natural disasters happening, this is the Lord Jesus is crying out like a roaring lion. My beloved, when we look around and we see the disasters that are happening around us, some will come and say, yeah, but they are doing it deliberately. There is cloud seeding and all these climate change nonsense. They are changing the climate deliberately and they want to flood this area and blow up that area. They are doing it. Science has advanced and technology has advanced. And they are capable of it. And by the way, cloud seeding is not a conspiracy theory. It's real. Chemtrail. You see the planes where they throw that white thing behind them. Chemtrail is not a conspiracy theory. It's real. Aluminum is one of the materials they throw from that plane. Poisonous. Poisonous. It's real. It's not a joke. But why are they able to do that? The Lord is angry. The Lord is upset. The Lord is sad. He says, my people have walked away from me. I only have a handful. Where is the rest? I healed 10 lepers. I only saw one coming back thanking me for it. Where is the other 9? I have so many children. I see one child coming to me. Where is the rest? I see my church in Europe turned into a restaurant, into a museum. Before it was packed with my children. Today it's empty. They are selling churches left, right, and center. Europe was a Christian nation. Today it is atheistic nation. Canada was a Christian. Today, gone. America, going, almost gone. Australia, gone with the wind. What happened? I'm the same God. I am the same Jesus yesterday, today, and forever. Why have you denied your Jesus? When you deny me, you'll have to suffer the consequences. It's not easy. They will make climate change a natural disaster because I'm roaring like a lion. And when the church supports climate change, that's even a greater disaster. It's a greater one. The church should not be involved in such nonsense. The church's role is to pray to the Almighty God, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the creator of heaven and the heaven of all heavens and the earth and everything that is in it. I believe the Lord Jesus can stabilize the climate if he wants to. Even when we drive our V8s, I like the V8s. The sound of the V8, man. Now that's a real car. Now we're going to be driving remote control cars. Fuel is too expensive. What's under the bonnet? 1.1 liter, four stroke. It's like a lawnmower. I put $50, last me for 1 month. Oh, now thanks to the geniuses of the 21st century, it's all going to be battery. Well, battery, that's poison. Lithium, what is it? Yeah, isn't that poison? Where are you going to hide that? My beloveds, the things that are happening in the world is very troublesome, very unstable. You look at the news, everywhere, everyone is on the edge. This guy hates this guy. This guy wants to rip into this guy. What is wrong with you people? Can you just enjoy the day and put the prawns on the barbie? And just enjoy it. Why have they lost their peace? Because they've lost God. They've lost God. We come back to Jesus, everything's beautiful. The moment we leave the Lord, we are living in turmoil. This is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help you, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, because he is God, revealed in the flesh. Family, at home, mom and dad, beg you, make a time. You bring your children, no matter how young they are, you bring them and you sit them at the table and you say, Mommy, Daddy, we are going to pray. Why? We need to thank the Lord Jesus for the house, for the roof, for the table, for the chairs, for everything, and for the food that we are about to eat. This is the Lord Jesus. It is him giving us all these blessings. Okay, son? Okay, daughter? Thank him. So we'll pray now. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the food we're about to eat. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for mom. And thank you for dad. And thank you for my brother and for my sister and for my grandma and for my grandpa. Thank the Lord for your family members, the good ones and those who are a pain in the neck. Thank the Lord for all of them. Thank him. Learn how to pray at home. Learn how to sit as a family unit at home. Stop going everyone for himself and for herself. We need to come back and acknowledge we are a family. I'm not a selfish individual. I belong to this family. And the ultimate family is the family of Christ, the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. I need to come into this family and thank my heavenly daddy for giving me such wonderful brothers and sisters. And good-looking bishop. We need to thank the Lord. We need to thank the Lord. And believe you me, enjoy the moment. Do not be troubled by what is going to happen tomorrow, because tomorrow Christ has got it in the palm of his hand already. Don't worry. Let the world do whatever. You focus on Christ. Enjoy this moment with the Lord and with your loved ones. The Lord always has a way for you, no matter how hard or difficult it is. He will always find a way for you. Trust me, I have experienced it till this very moment. My beard is gone like Santa Claus. Christ never forsaken me, never, not for one single moment. Never. Because he's God. He keeps his promises. He fulfills them, delivers them. He's wonderful. Just call him and give him everything you have. Hand it over. Lord, this house that I built, you built it, not me. It's yours. The family I have, it's yours. I am yours. Everything is yours. I'm a bishop. There's people that come to the church, but everything is the Lord's. I'm nothing but a useless, hopeless servant of the Lord. It is him who protects. It is him who calls. It is him who brings people. It is him who changes people, not me. I can't change my own self, let alone to change anyone else. But Christ changes everyone. We need to entrust him with everything. You are the leader. You are the good shepherd. Guide us, lead us to green pastures and still waters. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your staff and your rod, they comfort me. Amen. There you go. Not bad. We thank the Lord Jesus always, my beloveds. We thank the Lord Jesus always. Book of Revelation is for the 21st century. More so than any other century that has gone by so far. How long will this world last? Only God knows. When is the end? Only God knows. But are we living in the end of times? Yes. Are we living at the end of the world? I don't know. End of the world? Only God knows. God the Father. No one else. But it is definitely the end of times. So all we need to do is we need to pray and ask the Lord to open our minds, our hearts, our eyes to see and discern what is happening around us. Not to be afraid, but to be alert. And we need to be wise, not asleep along the line. We need to be awakened and realizing what is happening in order to know where to go, what to choose, and what not to choose. That's all. And enjoy it with the Lord. Enjoy it with the Lord, my beloveds. Amen. God bless you. If I could ask my beloved daughter in Christ, Nora, for another hymn. Before we come to the conclusion, that would be great. And while she's preparing that, I'll say this joke. Is that all right? And one. Okay, in advance, my apologies to all the wives in here. Please don't kill me, don't hit me, don't smack me. The husband said to his wife, he said, "Honey, do you remember how happy we were 20 years ago?" She kept on thinking. And then after a few seconds, she said, "Hun, we were not married 20 years ago." He said, "Exactly." Did you get it? All right, my dear Nora. Thank you.
worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand.
Amen. Let us stand for the finale prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Amen. May the Lord Jesus bless you, guide you, and protect you all the days of your life, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, my beloved. God bless.
I'm standing here before you, knowing you are in control, resting in your heavenly glory. Let your will be done for me. I cast my burdens onto you, Lord, knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing here in victory. darkest days, you're with me. Yeah, you have always been my strength. I cast my burdens onto you, Lord, and knowing you will take them all. I'm trusting in your blood you shed for me. I know you've covered all my sins. I'm standing here in victory, knowing you have done it all. You're deserving of the glory. Let us praise your holy name. Lord, we shout out to the heavens, worshiping your